did give a very basic talk in the first hour on Keller-Einstein matrix. And complex Monge-Ampère equations. So, for the basic notions, the very basic notions of Keller geometry. Can be as far as the Keller-Einstein matrix are concerned, can be explained by basic formulas in Keller geometry. So, I'm sorry for people who know already everything about that. But since it's a basic notion seminar, let's define a Keller manifold. To be a pair X omega, where X is a complex manifold. Omega is a real closed, declosed two form. Such that in local coordinates, let's call them ZA, Z to the A, so local holomorphic coordinates, of course, since we are looking on a complex manifold, so they are locally defined functions that define a biholomorphism from an open subset of X to an open subset of Cn. So such that in this local coordinates, omega, which is a closed form, expresses as a two form as I over 2. I is the complex number I square equals minus 1. J A beta bar dz A wedge dz bar beta. Okay. With the following further property that J A beta bar is an Hermitian matrix, which is strictly positive, and of course the J beta bar are locally defined smooth functions. Okay, then omega is called the Keller class, the Keller form. So it's a two form. And the main invariant of a Keller form is its cohomology class. Which is a second degree 2 Durham cohomology class. This being the set of real closed two forms on X. Divided by the exact two forms namely the ones that are co-boundaries of smooth one form. So this is the main invariant, and since we are in a very basic notions, we need to give examples. And the first example will be the complex projective space, which can be defined as the complement of the origin in Cn plus 1 divided by complex homothesis. So this is a complex manifold. And we have a certain form, which is omega fs for Fubinich 2D form. And which is given by the following formula, I over 2 pi, oh I'm sorry. So on the complex projective space, we have homogeneous coordinates, z naught, zn. They are complex numbers, n plus 1 complex numbers, not all 0, defined up to an homothesis. So when I write that this is a set of complex of homogeneous coordinates on Pn, I'm thinking of this as coordinates on Cn plus 1 and that have some homogeneity under this group. Okay, so in these coordinates, the omega Fubinich 2D form is given by that formula, I over 2 pi dd bar log of z naught square plus, etc., plus zn square, where d and d bar are explicitly given. Now, operators that take functions to, or more generally, forms. To d is d sum over all a of d over dza of d over dza, and here it goes to d over dz bar b d over dz bar. So of course if z is x plus y I, dz bar is nothing but dx minus I dy. Okay, in terms of forms. So we have these two natural operators that we will use a lot during these lectures. And they serve to define this Fubinich 2D form. So a priori it is defined only in Cn plus 1 minus 0. But for homogeneity reasons it descends. So it is it descends by the action of C star to a form of Pn of C. So if I would like to be more precise, I would say that the pullback to Cn plus 1 minus 0 of the omega Fubinich 2D form on Pn is given by this formula. But still this is a good form. And the fact is that Pn with this Fubinich 2D form is scalar. So that's the main example. A second important example is the following. So it's a theoretical example. If x omega is scalar, And Y is a complex manifold with an immersion I. Then the pullback by I of omega is a Keller form on Y. So this implies that the notion of a Keller manifold is hereditary, so it is preserved by holomorphic maps. So, when we look at two examples, we deduce the following corollary, that complex projective manifolds are Keller. So a complex projective manifold is nothing as a closed submanifold of the projective space, which is defined by as a common zero locus of a certain number of homogeneous polynomials. So since we can write down a lot of homogeneous polynomials, homogeneous forms of several variables, and since they generally cut out a locus which has no singularities, we have an ample supply of complex projective manifolds. And they are Keller. So also the study of these guys is a subject of complex algebraic geometry. Is one of the main subjects in complex algebraic geometry and the importance of Keller manifolds. Okay, not all Keller manifolds are complex projective manifolds, but anyway, this gives an immense zoology of examples. So, okay. Now, let's go into more specialized terminology. So if we have an N form on a complex manifold, we say it is of type PQ, where P and Q are two numbers, natural numbers, that add up to the natural number N. If and only, let's call it omega, if and only if, in local coordinates, omega takes the form dZa1, dZap, dz bar b1, dz bar bq. So this is a typical PQ form, but we have to add up take all linear combinations of such forms with smooth coefficients. So here is the general form in local coordinates of PQ form, and we will use a notation that omega is in lambda PQ. Quelle est leur forme? Is a closed one-one form in particular. Now it is interesting, as I told you, when you have a Keller form, the main invariant is the cohomology class of that form, the degree 2 cohomology class of that form, and it is important to know what are the closed 1-1 form in this Durham cohomology class. So this is an important question and basic question in Keller geometry that has been solved more than 60 years ago by Hodge, essentially. In case, of course, when X is compact. So, in fact, the omega does not need to be a Keller, it needs to be a 1-1 closed form. Real. Then, what Hodge proved essentially by the so-called Didibar lemma, I won't be more precise on that statement, is following that, let's call it alpha, since it is not necessarily Keller. The cohomology class of alpha intersected with smooth 1-1 forms is nothing. So the 1-1 forms, closed forms in the cohomology class of alpha is nothing than the set alpha plus I dd bar phi, where phi is a real valued smooth function on X. We say that alpha is Keller if and only if there exists phi such that I over dd bar phi is a Keller form. Which means that the cohomology class is Keller if and only if there is a Keller representative, a Keller 1-1 representative inside the cohomology class. And we denote that this relation by I dd bar phi is positive. By this we mean that when we write it in complex coordinates, so since it is a 1-1 form, we have a sum over I equals 1, cardinal of A equals 1, cardinal of B equals 1, so here we have a matrix here. which is Hermitian since it is real, and we ask that this matrix is positive. So this is there's a positivity notion. Of 1-1 forms that enable to talk of the sign, and it is a positive convex cone. It is necessary for any good notion of positivity. So let me give an example of interesting 1-1 of cohomology class of interesting 1-1 closed forms. So the example is very basic and is complex Hermitian geometry or Keller geometry goes into contact with algebraic geometry. It uses the notion of holomorphic line bundle. So holomorphic line bundle is something a complex manifold with a projection to X such that locally L with pi is isomorphic to the first projection of X cross C to X. When one says that one does not really give the definition of the line bundle, but we ask that the gluing data are of course holomorphic, since it's a complex manifold, are linear in the second variable. So that is what is holomorphic line bundle. So one can think of a twisted form of X times C. So of this basic product of X times C over X. Okay, so if we have an holomorphic line bundle, and if we have an Hermitian metric, which means that for all x in x, pi minus 1 x, which I will denote by Lx, endowed with h. So Lx is one-dimensional vector space over C, and H X is a metric. So we have a metric for each X on this vector space. So it's just given by some positive real number. And HX depend smoothly on X. Okay. So if we have a Hermitian metric on L, we can do the following construction. If L is a local holomorphic section, of L, which means that locally S is a function locally S defines function on X with values in C. Which is holomorphic. So if we have a local holomorphic section of L, and we have this metric, then we can measure its norm with respect to the metric. We can take, so it's a positive smooth function. We can take his log, and we can apply minus 1 I over 2 pi dd bar log of S square. Okay. And this depends a priori on S. This is a 1-1 form that I call theta, and it depends on S. In fact, if S prime is another local holomorphic section, theta of S prime is the same thing as theta of S. The reason being that S prime is F times S, where F is a local holomorphic function. Which never vanishes. So when we compute log of S prime square with respect to H, we get log of Fs square with respect to S, but this is an Hermitian metric, so we get log of F square times this, then this gives log of F square plus log of S square of H. Then, upon computing the minus I over 2 pi of dd bar of both sides, we get that theta S prime equals theta of S plus I over 2 pi dd bar of log F square. And this is zero because log of F square is locally log of f plus log of f bar. And if we take the d bar of that, then the d bar of log of f is zero, because log of f is holomorphic, and this is Cauchy-Riemann equations. So this is just d bar of log of f bar. And if we compute the dd bar, then we get dd bar, d and d bar anti-commute. And d of log f bar is nothing but the conjugate of d bar of log f, which still vanishes by the Cauchy-Riemann equations. So theta s prime is indeed equal to theta of s. Okay, what we get is a global closed 1-1 form. This construction gives, I will call C1 of LH, the first Chernweil form of LH. Which is closed, real, and which is equal to theta of S for all S, a local holomorphic section of the bundle. Okay. So this is a 1-1 form, and it is interesting to note that if we have a Hermitian form and a smooth function, we can twist the Hermitian metric by the factor x, the weight exponential to the minus phi, and here we get, by definition, that the first Chernweil form of L h to the minus phi is C1 of LH plus I dd bar I over 2 pi dd bar phi. So we can put the 2 pi inside F. In particular, the cohomology class of the Chernweil form intersected with the 1-1 representative in this are nothing but the set of all Chernweil forms of this twisted matrix. So in fact, every Hermitian metric take that form. So we get that the 1-1 forms in the cohomology class are nothing but the Chernweil forms of the various Hermitian metrics on L. So in particular, it does not this cohomology class does not depend on H, and this is what we called the first Chern class of L, the holomorphic line bundle L, And this is what we will call the first Chern veil form of LH. So this is really a very basic notion. The most interesting example, it can be argued that the most interesting example of an holomorphic line bundle is nothing but what is called the canonical line bundle. I will describe it right away. It will be called K of X, the canonical line bundle. So what is a canonical line bundle? The canonical line bundle is a holomorphic line bundle whose local sections holomorphic take the form f of z dz1 wedge dzn, where this is holomorphic. In fact, it is a bundle of holomorphic and zero forms. Okay. So this is the canonical bundle, and one of the reasons the canonical bundle is the most interesting of all line bundles can be tracked back to the following construction. If H is a metric on Kx, and zi are holomorphic coordinates, then we can form holomorphic one form, n form, dz1, dzn, so that is a section of the canonical bundle. And we may take its square norm with respect to H. But this is a n form, so we may make it real by multiplying it by its conjugate. We divide the resulting nn form by this quantity, which comes from a metric. And we see that it does not depend on the holomorphic, the set of holomorphic coordinates we choose. Basically, by construction. So the homogeneity here is exactly killed by the homogeneity upstairs. And we call it, this is a nn form, which means it is a 2n form. A complex manifold being an oriented two n-dimensional real manifold. This is a top form, and which has a positive sign. If we put here a certain fixed constant. So this is a volume form. So when we have a metric on Kx, we can construct a volume form, and basically by construction we get an equivalence between volume forms and metrics on the canonical line bundle. So we have this equivalence. The next step is to introduce a definition. If H is an Hermitian metric on Kx or a volume form V, the Ricci form of V divided by 1 over 2 pi is a 1-1 form given by I over 2 pi dd bar log h. Which is also the same thing as minus I over 2 pi dd bar log of, which is minus the Chernevay form of Kx with respect to H, where we have assumed that V is a volume form associated to VH. So this is the Ricci 1-1 form of a volume form. The Ricci curvature of Keller metric is by definition the Ricci curvature of its natural volume form. So omega is a Keller form, so it's a 1-1 form. When we raise it to the power n, we get a nn form, which is basically, if g is like that, is given by this local coordinates. The top power is up to a certain other constant, the determinant of g alpha beta bar times dz dz bar, whereby dz dz bar I denote by abuse of language this quantity. So this is essentially the dd bar log is essentially I over 2 pi dd bar log of the determinant of g alpha beta bar. Okay. So remark in I will be very brief out of that. In general, in Riemannian geometry, one defines the Ricci curvature as a symmetric two form. Now, on Keller manifold, this symmetric two form is actually Hermitian two form. And there is a correspondence between Hermitian forms and 1-1 forms. And this is why in Keller geometry, and this is a complete equivalence. So in Keller geometry, one prefers to work with 1-1 forms. So apparently alternative forms in place of symmetric forms, which should be the case in general Riemannian geometry. So I won't spend time on making the connection with Riemannian geometry. It's for our purpose. We can just give these definitions. So, okay. Now, after this very basic notions have been introduced, we will explain a very basic calculation, which is the reduction of the Keller-Einstein condition to a complex Monge-Ampère equation. So this is the main motivation for, as far as global differential geometry is concerned, to study the very complicated PDE that is called the complex Monge-Ampère equation. So let's give a definition. Compact Keller manifold, say compact, X omega, is Keller-Einstein. If and only if, with cosmological constant. Lambda, a real number. If and only if the Ricci form of omega is lambda omega. Okay. So this is inspired by the Einstein equations in general relativity, but it is the concept of Riemannian geometry that Riemannian manifold is Einstein if its Ricci curvature is proportional to the metric tensor, the metric itself. So that's a nice condition to be put on a metric. And it has several applications, but before tackling this, let us give a lemma about Keller-Einstein manifold with a non-vanishing so cosmological constant. Such manifolds are projective algebraic. The proof is interesting. We assume that lambda is positive. Then Ricci of omega is equal to lambda omega, lambda being positive, this implies that this is scalar. So the Ricci form, which actually is in the first Chern form of the canonical line bundle minus one, is scalar. In particular, the dual kx minus 1 of the canonical line bundle has a Hermitian metric with positive Chern-Weyl form. Then, this implies by a very important theorem of Kodaira that there is some tensor power of the anti-canonical line bundle that has non-trivial holomorphic sections global holomorphic sections and also that the map from X to the projective space Pn of C, where n Pm of C, where m plus 1 is the dimension of this vector space, that sends the point X to the point with homogeneous coordinates S0, Sm, where S0 of X, where S0, Sm are form a basis of the space. That this is an embedding. So this implies by Chow's theorem that X is projective. And in fact, that kx minus 1 is ample, which is the definition of x being Fano. For lambda negative, the same argument gives that kx is ample, which gives that x is so-called canonically polarized. Okay. So let's finish by a lemma. Well, not a lemma, but let's say a proposition. Let X be so a complex Kenner manifold, so projective, and Kx is ample, so that we may find a Keller-Einstein metric with negative Kolmogorov constant. Omega in the cohomology class of Kx, a Keller form. It is easy to see that if Kx is ample, so that this is an embedding, then the pullback of the Fubinich 2D form is a Keller form. So there is a Keller form in this Keller class. The cohomologous omega 1-1 form omega plus IDD bar phi is a Keller-Einstein metric if and only if omega is plus IDD bar phi is positive, all representative need not be positive, and omega plus IDD bar phi raised to the power n, so it is a volume form of that Keller form, is e over 2 pi phi times v, where v is a volume form such that 1 over 2 pi Ricci of v equals minus omega. This exists by the theorems I was by the DD bar lemma and the theory of Chandler form. So this proposition is rather easy to prove. In fact, for this direction, it's enough to compute I or minus I over 2 pi DD bar of log of the left hand side. So this is Ricci form of omega by definition, and this is by the equation minus I DD bar of phi minus I over 2 pi minus I over 2 pi of the Ricci form of V, so minus omega. If one computes minus I over DD bar of log of this quantity. So in particular, this is minus omega plus I DD bar of phi. Similarly, for positive cosmological constant. But there is another lemma which is important, that if X is a compact Keller manifold and omega is Keller, and we assume that the canonical class is zero, the Durham cohomology, then omega plus I DD bar of phi is Ricci flat, means lambda equals zero Keller-Einstein metric, if and only if omega plus I DD bar of phi n equals v, where v is a unique volume form with Ricci curvature of V is 0, which exists by this condition. And also, since this is a closed form, the volume here is invariant. So the integral of this volume form is independent of phi. So we need that this condition be satisfied. So the very important theorem that was proved by Yao is that it was published in 87. 78 is that whenever x is as kx ample, then it has a unique Keller-Einstein metric of negative cosmological constant, or when x has kx equals 0, then there is a unique Ricci-flat metric in every Keller class. So this theorem was proved by solving this kind of equation in the canonically polarized case, and this kind of equation that is very similar looking in the Ricci flat case. So I think that now I have exposed the most basic notions of Keller-Einstein matrix, and in the next hour I will give more recent developments and variants